Good evening and welcome to our Wednesday night Bible study at Lee Chapel AME Church. We're certainly so glad that you have chosen to tune in and to join us for Bible study tonight. It has been a great week. I pray that the Lord has continued to bless you for the first half of this week. My prayer is also that you will continue to be blessed throughout the rest of this week. I know we've had some exciting situations with school starting in some of our areas and parents and children and teachers having to get acquainted to this new process of virtual learning. So our prayers are with you, that you continue to be able to be diligent in your work and that God continue to bless you in that. And so one of the blessings of having a midweek Bible study is that we get a chance to gather together. We get a chance to encourage one another about the steps that God has taken us through to be better people. But more than that, we get to dive into God's Word and we get to be fed by this Holy Spirit interpreting and opening up Scripture for us. And that's why I really love Bible study so much, because it gives a chance to dive into the text and to see more about it. Indeed, every time that we gather, it is our hope that we learn something more about the character of God, something more about the human condition, and even something about the particular text that we are reading. And so my hope tonight is that we will at least get two of those things out of our Bible study tonight. And again, I'm asking you to center yourself, allow God's Holy Spirit to speak to you. And then we pray that God will open up His Scripture to us tonight, that our souls may be fed by His Word. Amen? All right, let us first turn to Acts chapter 15. We're in verses 1 through 21 tonight. There are many more verses in Acts chapter 15, but as you know, oftentimes we'll break up our chapter so that we can get something out of each section. So we're going to be in verses 1 through 21 tonight in Acts chapter 15. And I invite you to turn there with me. Also acknowledge that if you do have your own version, please feel free to read along with us. But the scripture will be put on the screen for you. Acts chapter 15 in the New Revised Standard Version. Let us hear the word of the Lord at this time, verses 1 through 21. Then certain individuals came down from Judea and were teaching the brothers, "Unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved." And after Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and debate with them, Paul and Barnabas and some of the others were appointed to go up to Jerusalem to discuss this question with the apostles and the elders. So they were sent on their way by the church. And as they passed through both Phoenicia and Samaria, they reported the conversion of Gentiles and brought great joy to all the believers. When they came to Jerusalem, they were welcomed by the church and the apostles and the elders, and they reported all that God had done with them. But some of the believers who belonged to the sect of the Pharisees stood up and said, "It is necessary for them to be circumcised in order to keep the law of Moses." The apostles and the elders met together to consider this matter. After there had been much debate, Peter stood up and said to them, "My brothers, you know that in the early days God made a choice among you, that I should be the one through whom the Gentiles would hear the message of the good news and become believers. And God, who knows the human heart, testified to them by giving them the Holy Spirit, just as he did to us. And in cleansing their hearts by faith, he has made no distinction between them and us. Now therefore, why are you putting God to the test by placing on the neck of the disciples a yoke that neither our ancestors nor we have been able to bear? On the contrary, we believe that we will be saved through the grace of the Lord Jesus, just as they will." The whole assembly kept silence and listened to Barnabas and Paul as they told of all the signs and wonders that had been done through them among the Gentiles. After they finished speaking, James replied, "My brothers, listen to me. Simeon has related how God first looked favorably upon the Gentiles to take from among them a people for his name. This agrees with the words of the prophets, as it is written, 'After this, I will return, and I will rebuild the dwelling of David, which has fallen from its ruins. I will rebuild it, and I will set it up, so that all other people may seek the Lord, even all the Gentiles over whom my name has been called. Thus says the Lord, who has been making these things known from long ago. Therefore, I have reached the decision that we should not trouble those Gentiles who are turned to God, but we should write to them to abstain only from the things polluted by idols and from fornication and from whatever has been strangled and from blood. For in every city for generations past, Moses has had those who proclaim him, for he has been read aloud every Sabbath in the synagogues. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hear us, and do us of his holy word. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for this day. We thank you, God, for this Wednesday afternoon, Lord, a chance for us to gather and to hear your word. We pray, O Lord, that you will continue to bless us with your presence. We ask, Heavenly Father, that you will open up the scriptures that we may fully understand the word that is written. We pray, Heavenly Father, that you will give us peace of mind. Allow, O God, your word to penetrate our hearts and feed our spirits. This, O Lord, is our prayer in your Son, Jesus the Christ's name. Amen. All right, so we're in Acts chapter number 15. And as you know, I try to do just a brief recap so that if there are those who have not tuned in with us before, you may know exactly where we're coming from. And also for those who've been with us, but just may need a brief reminder of where we have been, this is beneficial also. So, you know, the beginning with the first chapter in Acts, we see where Peter and the apostles are there on the day of Pentecost, and Peter preaches, and all of those who are listening hear the word of God in their own language. And this was so important because they were living in all different parts of the world and, of course, had learned different languages. And so when they come back to Jerusalem for a festival, they hear Peter preaching in their own language. And of course, by this miracle, they begin to believe in Jesus the Christ. Of course, some time passes on, and the religious leaders of that particular city didn't want Peter and the disciples preaching about Jesus anymore, and they warned them not to do that. And of course, Peter and the disciples were kind of hesitant, but then they prayed for boldness. And God gave them a spirit of boldness, which allowed them to go forward and to proclaim his word. After this, one day Peter is walking along with John, and they see a man who is at this gate of the city called the Beautiful Gate. And he has his cup out there waiting for people to give him silver or for gold to help him be able to feed himself. And Peter and John say to this man, "Silver and gold we don't have, but what we have is the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you believe in him, we believe you will be made whole. Stand up and walk." Well, this man, of course, his legs began to heal, his ankles began to heal, and he was able to stand up and walk. When the people saw this, they again were amazed at how much power Peter and John had in their testimony and in the proclamation about God. And of course, they began to believe in Jesus. Well, of course, the religious leaders didn't like this, so they put Peter and John in jail. So as they were in jail, the Holy Spirit came in and assured Peter that they would no longer have to be in jail and that they would be able to be freed miraculously. So the Holy Spirit literally walked them out of the jail, didn't disturb the guards, didn't disturb the doors. And the next day when Peter's out proclaiming the word of God, the jailers were astonished and went back to make sure everything was still all right. Indeed, nothing had been disturbed. And so now Peter, walking along the power of God, the Bible declares that even his shadow had God's power in it, and people were healed because they were falling up under the power of his shadow. Well, some time goes forward, and Peter and the disciples are trying to create this beloved community, a community where none suffer lack, and asking people to give of all their goods and support the entire community. And in this instance, the widows and orphans who were to receive their daily ration of food did not receive it as timely as they should have, and they complained to the disciples about the fact that they didn't get the daily rations. The disciples then created an order of ministry called deacons, or diakonos, which comes from that Greek word, which means to be a waiter. Out of this group, Stephen was chosen to be the first one. And of course, Stephen was full of the Holy Spirit and did his job very well. He also began to proclaim the word of God among those who were in the city. And the religious leaders, of course, didn't like this and then found him one day and stoned him to death. Well, as they were stoning him, there was a man there who was holding the coats of the people who were stoning him. His name was Saul. Sometime later, the same man, Saul, would begin to persecute Christians also. But on his way on this road called Damascus to get more orders to persecute Christians, he was able to have an encounter with God, whereby the word of God struck him off of his horse, and God's voice rang out to him from heaven saying, "Saul, you are persecuting me. You are stopping the spreading of the good news." After this, Saul was converted and changed his name to Paul and began to preach the good news to the entire known world. Well, of course, the issue of Gentiles and Jewish converts was going to be an issue that would have to be dealt with at some point in time. Peter believed, as many others did, that the first and only persons who were supposed to be recipients of God's salvation were to be Jewish adherents who now became Christians. But one night he had an epiphany when God showed him that he should go speak to a man named Cornelius, who was a Gentile, and offer him salvation. Peter did this, and Cornelius and his whole family were saved. Well, we fast forward and see that Paul and Barnabas are going around proclaiming God's word, and they're going to the synagogue and proclaiming it, but Gentiles are also hearing the word of God, and they're also starting to believe in Jesus, and they're also receiving salvation. And everything is fine until this particular moment of contention where people want to know about what rules should be applied to the Gentile converts over and against the rules for Jewish converts. Now, let me go back very briefly and remind you that one particular thing happened in a city where Paul and Barnabas were. The people began to call them Zeus and Hermes because they were worshiping a pantheon of Greek gods and Roman gods and didn't have any proof that they existed, but they were trying to find some meaning in life. And that's important for us to talk about in our Bible study, because we will also encounter people who are trying to find meaning in life, trying to find a reason for why things are happening, particularly as we talk about COVID-19 shutdown and pandemics and unemployment. And the word of God provides that for them. It reminds us also of our need to stay steadfast and faithful to God as we study God's word. All right, so that's our catch up. We are here at Acts chapter 15, verses 1 through 21. And there's some concern, again, about the Gentiles and what they should be doing and what those who are Jewish converts should be doing, and should there be a difference made between them. So that picks up with verse 15, question number one, gets us right into it. What problems were some of the believers having with the Gentiles? What problems were some of the believers having with the Gentiles? Let's look at verse number 5. But some believers who belonged to the sect of the Pharisees stood up and said, it is necessary for them to be circumcised and ordered to keep the law of Moses. So you had persons who were formerly Pharisees who are now converted to Christianity. Their issue is that they believe that those who are Gentiles who were never following the Judaism religion, never following the law of Moses, that they should first follow these laws and then become converted. Now, this is a common thing that happens in so many areas of life. So many times we achieve a certain level of success, a certain level of freedom, a certain level of achievement, and then somebody comes behind us and doesn't necessarily have to go through all of the pitfalls we went through, all of the difficulties we went through, and there can be a desire by some to subject somebody to that same process before they achieve freedom. Of course, there are others who believe that if someone has made it possible for you to have success, have achievements without having to go through all these processes, then you should be able to do that. Commonly, we hear the phrase, you know, used, we're standing on someone else's shoulders. We're standing on the shoulders of those who've come before us. That is an indication that progress has been made and we are building upon that progress. And so we see the similar conversation being had here, because you have some Pharisaic Jews who are now Christians who are saying, we had to obey the law of Moses. We had to go through all these things. And yes, we know that we're not up under the law anymore. We're up under grace. But we think it's good for them to obey the law of Moses, because in doing so, they understand the need for salvation and the need for grace. They also believe that they should be circumcised, that they should have to be cut in their foreskin, that they were men. And so there's this debate going on. Should they have to become a part of Judaism or adhere to Judaism before they worship Christianity or become Christians? Or can they just come right in? And that was something that was highly debated in the church, primarily because there was concern about them not knowing who God was from this perspective, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm gonna tell you something right now. There is even, in modern times, some question about should people read the Old Testament and the New Testament, or should they only read the New Testament? Should they even consider the Ten Commandments as part of the requirements that they have in their life? Because now God's word said we're up under grace. And so this is not just something that happened then, but something that happens now. My response has always been this. If you look at the question that the disciples posed to Jesus, they said to him, they asked him this question, what is the greatest commandment? His response to them was, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And the second, right, is that you should love your neighbor as yourself. And upon these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Of course, we say that every Sunday in our summary of the Decalogue, but there's a good amount of information in there because what Jesus is saying to them is this: you can't just throw away the laws of Moses, right? Even though you're under grace, you can't just throw away the laws of Moses, because principally the law of Moses was given to give us guardrails in life, to give us an indication of what sin was, so we would not transpose, or rather transgress, those particular requirements. And so the law of Moses, even though it's difficult for anybody to adhere to, it is still valuable because it is still good for us to know, hey, I shouldn't steal, I shouldn't kill, I shouldn't bear false witness, I should not commit adultery, I should not covet those things that are my neighbor's, I should not have any other gods before the God that created me, right? And so these are good examples of how we should live our life. So what we're principally talking about is, we're not required, right, to live up under the law. But the Bible also teaches us that in living by the law, we make it easier for us to live up under grace. If I adhere to loving the Lord my God with all my heart, mind, and soul, and loving my neighbor as myself, I'm not going to mistreat my neighbor. I'm not going to worship any other God other than the one that created me, which means I'm not going to worship myself. And one of the difficulties we have in life is oftentimes we worship ourselves. We're the biggest idol that we have because we seek to satisfy ourselves, we seek to please ourselves, and we seek to make ourselves satisfied. And what God says is, that's the wrong thing to do. So how do I keep from worshiping myself, right? I look at the Ten Commandments. How do I keep from not loving my neighbor as myself? I refer back to the Ten Commandments and all of the law of Moses. I try to use that as a guide for how I should live my life. And if you do the same thing, I guarantee you, you will find that you can adhere to those principles and you can adhere to having a better life under grace. And so we see that some of the believers had a problem with the Gentiles not obeying the law of Moses first and then just coming in up under grace. Okay? So now, Peter hears this and Peter has a response to them. Second question asks this: what was Peter's response to the concern over the Gentiles? What was Peter's response to the concern over the Gentiles? Verses 10 and 11 give us some insight into this. Look at what verse 10 says. Now, therefore, why are you putting God to the test by placing on the neck of the disciples a yoke that neither our ancestors, neither nor we have been able to bear? On the contrary, we believe that we will be saved through the grace of the Lord Jesus just as they will. What Peter says is this: how are you going to require them to obey the law of Moses when you couldn't? How am I going to require them to adhere to all the laws of Moses when you had difficulty? Peter's approach is logical because he's saying, if we had obeyed the law of Moses, we wouldn't need grace. Think about that. If we had obeyed the law of Moses, we would not need grace. But the point is, we can't obey the law of Moses, not because it's impossible, but I believe I said in the previous Bible study, it's because we have a propensity and probability of getting off track. Our sinful nature leads us to give in to our desires. What I talked about Sunday, with the encounter with God and how our life would be markedly changed, that we change our nature, that we change our name, and we change our perspective. If we were to do that, we could live by the law of Moses and we would live a life worthy of God's calling. But every once in a while, we get off track for whatever reason. Every once in a while, maybe you've been obeying God's word for 6 months in a row, hitting that mark every day, every hour, you've been on it. But maybe that next hour, something causes you to get off track. Whatever it is, maybe your desire to be godly is just worn out. Maybe you're exhausted, maybe you're tired, maybe you're fed up with being godly, I don't know. But we all miss the mark. We all will make a wrong decision. So what God said is this: knowing that you will, let me give you some insurance called grace. Now, I have insurance on my car. I don't want to be in an accident. I prefer not to be in an accident, but I have insurance just in case I am in an accident. And so God also says to us, I know you don't want to sin. I know that you'd prefer not to sin. But just in case you do, there's this thing called forgiveness. There's this thing called grace. There's this thing called justification, where you're treated just as if you've never sinned. And Jesus provides justification for us through his shed blood. And so what we understand is this. We live up under grace because God makes it available to us in case we need it. Now, we had on our prayer call this week a question about, well, since we have grace, should we sin more? No, by no means should we do that, right? We should do this. We should, at every attempt, try not to, right, live a sinful life. So our prayer call was about, you know, should we do this? No, we should not do this so that it abounds more. We should be able to live upon the grace and enjoy God's good pleasure, all right? So Peter presents this argument to them. Now, we come to a final conclusion. How did the disciples ask the Gentiles to treat food offered to idols? How did the disciples ask the Gentiles to treat food offered to idols? So the disciples said, let's come to an agreement here. You want them to adhere to the law of Moses on this extreme? We're saying to you that it's too much for them to do because we can't do it ourselves. Can we find a happy medium? And so what the disciples say is this. Look at verse number 20. But we should write to them to abstain only from things polluted by idols and from fornication and from whatever has been strangled and from blood. Now, here's what was going on. As I told you earlier, when Paul and Barnabas went to a certain city, they met some people, and when they healed this man, the people began to call them Zeus and Hermes, because these were the Roman gods that they were worshiping. And so now, I'm sorry, the Greek gods that they were worshiping, the Roman counterpart would have been Jupiter. But they're calling him Zeus because they see this man healed. So now you understand that there were plenty of mythological gods out there, and what their adherents would do, what their worshipers would do, is they would offer a sacrifice of food to them. They would put these items of food at the foot of the idol or the idol god at their temple, and they would offer this food to them. After the ceremony, they would then take this food and go sell it in the marketplace. So now what you have a situation is people were buying food that had been offered to idols in the marketplace, and they're buying it at a reduced cost. And so what the disciples are saying is, listen, we know that you don't worship this God anymore, but just to keep you from even going down that path, don't eat food that's been offered to idols, even if it's at a lower price, right? And abstain from fornication, abstain from food that has been, you know, animals that have been strangled and still have blood running through it. And so they gave them about three or four different things to adhere to in the hopes that they would find these things easier to do and have some close parallel to what the disciples were already doing as former followers of Judaism. And so they had a happy medium there. They weren't going to require them to worship, adhere to all the things of Moses' law, but just a few things. Now, this is important compromise because what the disciples were saying is, we understand you're coming in, being under grace, but we also think you need some guardrails, some things to govern your life by. This is going to become an important conversation later on, because what we're going to find is there's going to be a question about, you know, what does freedom look like in Jesus Christ? What does it look like for us to have freedom to worship God and freedom to be free of sin and also keep ourselves from going too far out there? All right. So listen, I hope that you have had a wonderful time following us so far in this 15th chapter. We've dived in here. Next week, we're going to dive in verses 22 through 42, I believe is what's left there. So my prayer is that you continue to follow us in our Bible study. Continue to allow God to minister to your heart and mind. Continue to let the Lord bless you and keep you, and let his face shine upon you. Stay steadfast in these difficult times. Stay close to God and allow the Holy Spirit to minister to you. We will all get through these difficult times together. Here's what I want you to remember. In every difficult time that humanity has faced, God has always been there, and God has always been to help them come through it. And so too he will with us. All right. Until next time, may God bless you and keep you is my prayer.